Hello, dear students. Samir Velandkar here. Welcome all of you to another session of Python. And this is the fourth week of Python programming that we are learning. So I was saying that I don't believe in the word called complex programming. Because as far as I have learned programming and I have been doing it, I know there are only three aspects of programming: input, process, and output. And most of the students or beginners think that the middle job, that is process, is very difficult. There is no adventure in input and output. But let me tell you, the skill of writing a program is all about knowing what is input and what should be the output. If we don't know this in advance, we can't write the process. Going through a long journey of programming, I have found that all the process that has been designed have come from very simple ideas. And then I learned that the process is something which we already know. We know it, but machine doesn't know it. Like if I ask you, is 17 a prime number? You will instantly say, yes, 17 is a prime number. But believe me, our machine doesn't know it. And we will have to teach the machine, how do you check whether 17 is a prime number or not? But do you know how to check, is 17 a prime number? Yes, you will say. You will say 17 is a prime number because it is divisible only by 1 and 17. It is not divisible by any other number. So you know the process. But that process, we must be able to write it for understanding of the machine. That's the skill we need to develop. And I have been always telling that computer is an idiot box. Yeah, I know I am a teacher of artificial intelligence, but machine is an idiot box. At least till this date, it is idiot box. You give it wrong formula, it will evaluate the wrong formula very loyally and give you the output. So how do you make machine intelligent is this course all about, and machine learning. You will see as we proceed that you can actually inject. You can inject intelligence, but that intelligence will also have some errors. It won't match the human intelligence. What we call it as intuition, you know, intuition is inbuilt in us. And intuitively we know, although it is rainy season and it starts raining, but we know that this rain is going to stop very soon. And someday or the other, it starts raining and we know that this rain is going to last for long. We are not environmentalist, but it's our intuition that we have got after living on this Mother Earth for so many years. We have learned the atmosphere or the environment, and we are applying it through past data about the environment that we have stored in our mind. But that intuition is so perfect, so perfect. Even today morning, it started raining. I told my family, this is not going to last for long, and it happened like that. Suddenly it stopped raining. Don't curse me. I know that it should rain heavily now. It's high time. As usual, Jupyter Notebook welcomes us. Hello everyone again. Good evening. What's the plan? See, in the past, we have learned, or rather in the previous week, we have learned some topics called data structures. We learned how list works, how tuple works, and sets. These three things we learned. And we began with dictionary data structure. This was the last in the series. And while learning all this, we were learning differences between them. Like lists are modifiable, you can modify a list, but tuple cannot be modified. And both list and tuple are ordered, they have indexes, but sets do not have indexes. And then we learned many functions also on list, tuple, sets. And we just started dictionary, but we have not finished it. But then sorry to say, I have changed my plan for this week. I'm not going to tell you what dictionary is. I know I am leaving this topic incomplete. I will visit dictionary later, but it is high time. And we learn today and tomorrow what are functions in Python. So we are giving a break to this data structures and list, tuples, and sets. We will very soon visit this. And functions is the topic we are now encouraged. So, beginning with what is a function? I am not discussing what is function in Python. I am discussing in general what is a function. Now, just imagine we have written a program and the program contains several statements. Imagine these are the statements in my program. And just imagine for a sake of comfort that this is a 500 line program. Imagine. And what you observe, you know, as a programmer, these two lines, or rather three lines, these three lines that you have written, these three lines are exactly the same lines you have written here. Absolutely. There is no difference between these three lines and these three lines. But then as a programmer, you are typing them again. And just imagine that these three lines have been written 50 times by you at various places in this 500 line code. Now, obviously, as a programmer, you will get irritated after some time saying that I am writing the same lines of code again and again, meaning that although I know that these lines are going to do the same job, but I need them. I need these lines here. I need these lines here. But then I have to still type them. And then you get an idea of function. What you do is you take these three lines and you group it inside a function. You define a function. Okay. FN for short, and give some name to the function. Let's say name of the function is fun. So under this name, fun, under this name, you will see these three lines are there. Okay. Now what you do as programmer, once you have defined this fun function, see, you remove these three lines. You don't write these three lines, but just write the name of the function fun. When this name is encountered by Python or by C or C++ or Java, what it does is it simply calls the function. That's the word. So the control was actually coming down, executing this program. When this line runs, control switches to the function, runs these three lines, and then comes back to the next line. And then program continues. And then instead of writing these three lines, you again call the function because the same lines you want. So again, fun will be called. Again, the three lines will run. And then the control will come back to the next line. Such a simple idea. So now, instead of writing three lines again and again, you just have to write one line, which is called to the function. Can you just imagine that these repetitive lines were not three, but were 30 lines? So 30 lines you are writing again and again. How much saving you are doing by helping yourselves by designing a function? Many people, many authors call function as routine also, or subroutine, or procedure, or method. Any name you take, all mean the same. Somebody says, I have designed a method in Python. You say, okay, you have designed a function in Python. All the words are same. Okay, having learned what is the use of function, why do you write function? Then you get some words like modular programming. Oh, good Lord, what is all this? Modular programming. Such a technical word, but actually function is many times called as module also. Okay. So what you are doing is, instead of writing all the program at a stretch, line after line, what you've done is you've cut these lines and put inside the function. And the function is a module. So whenever you write program by distributing the lines in various functions, then you say, I am doing modular programming because I have divided my task into smaller module. And from today, I will encourage all of you to do modular programming. It's because whenever we, even in real life, have got some big task to do, we will think of that big task into smaller parts. And we will try to solve that smaller parts, which are functions. And then we will say that the big task is done. Okay. So I hope I have given you enough idea about what is a function. Now let's come to grammar. How do you define a function in Python? Just check. In Python, when you want to define a function, you write a def keyword. Define def. And immediately after def, you write name of the function. Now name of the function is user defined name. That means we decide what will be the name of the function. But just take care that the name of the function should not be reserved word. Like, don't write the name of the function as for or while. Okay? Because all these are reserved words in Python, or keywords or special words. But then any other name which doesn't exist in the dictionary of Python or in Python vocabulary can be used. For example, I may write a function called f1. This becomes the function name, and after the function name, always there is a bracket given. Always, check my words. And inside the bracket, you may or may not write a parameter. Suppose if I write x, then this x is called parameter or argument. Both words are same. Argument of the function. So what does a function begin with? Def, name of the function, bracket, compulsory bracket. Inside that, you may or may not write parameter. That means this bracket can be empty. But I have written the parameter x here. After that, there comes a colon character. Recall the colon character which came after for or while. What happens after the colon? When you hit enter, the cursor automatically gets indented. I'll show you that in Jupyter Notebook. And now, here, the indented code that you write will be the body of the function. Okay? I said that function will contain some statements which are commonly used, isn't it? So those lines will be there in this. Okay? So, let's take up a problem here. The problem is that I want to write a function. Very simple example I am taking, as usual. I want to write a function. Here goes the question. Write a function which finds square of a number. Square of a number. That's it. That's the question. Okay? So what I will do is I'll define a function and I will name the function as square. Just check, there is no rule that you should name the function as square only. You can give any user defined name. For example, you can call this function as squa or sq, any name you can give. I have given the name square and I have a parameter x. Reason will become apparent. And then colon. And the body of the function I am writing is return x multiplied by x. That's it. This becomes a function. Okay, without wasting any time. Now I will write rest of the code. Just check, after return x into x, after this line, I am outdenting and I am writing remaining code just under this def, just under this. Just check this. Here I am writing the code. Now the line placed over here is c is equal to square 2 and then print c. Okay, just in next 5 minutes, the major part of the topic functions is going to get over. What I am going to tell you in next 5 minutes is the thing about the function. That's it. If you remember this, then you know functions in all languages. Just see, this is my program, Python program, and now I run it. What do you think? Which line will run first? Think over it. Which line will run first? Any beginner would say that Python program starts from the top. So this line will run first. Because it is written on the top, then this line, next line will run, that is return. No. The statement that will run first is what you have written in the main script. What? Yes. There is a script written, which is the main script. And the main script is written below the function. Check, this portion is the main script. So the execution of the program will not start from here, although it is written on the top. Python program will start running from this line. Okay? So this line runs. Now this line is c is equal to square 2. This is called function call. Function call. Come on. The name of the function is square, def square x we have written. And this is clearly we are calling the function by its name. But just observe, while calling the function, we have written the bracket and we have written 2. Now what happens is, when this function gets called, the control of the program jumps to the function. That is the first line of the function. And this two will literally get copied in X. That's the parameter. If you are asked next time, why do you write parameter? You say parameter is meant for receiving the value that you pass when you call the function. X literally receives 2. And now this function def square x will start running. But there is only one line written in the square function, return x into x. It means the function is going to return 2 into 2. Why? Because x had received the value 2. So the function is going to return 4. 2 into 2, x into x. Now, whenever I explain this statement return, I say there is nothing to explain in this. Come on, return means return. Return what? Return 4. Return where? Obviously, from where this function was called. So 4 is going to be thrown back as the answer. And when the return statement runs, the function will finish. So obviously, when the function finishes, the caller, whoever had called this, will resume. Who had called this? Main script. Main script will resume and 4 is returned. Now here comes the next question. Okay, 4 is returned. Are you seeing 4 flying back? First 2 had flown to the function. X received 2. And then now the function is throwing back 4. But where will this 4 get returned? 99% of the times I get answer that 4 will be returned in C. Because C is equal to is return. C is equal to this. So 4 will be returned in C. Maximum times I get this answer, which is wrong. Sorry to say. No, 4 is not returned in C. 4 is returned at the call. 4 will be returned at the call. Where is the call? Come on, this is the call. Here is the call. So 4 is returned here. Tell me, who is 4? Square of 2 is 4. Yes, square of 2 has got evaluated to 4. So 4 is returned at the call. And obviously then C is waiting greedily on the left hand side. So C will become 4. And then next line is print 4 because we are printing C. So try to understand what we are learning is how to define function with def keyword, and then how to call the function, and then value returned by the function is returned at the call. Trust me, if you remember this much, you have conquered half of the battle. Not half, I will say 90% of the battle. This is function, that's it. And then small little things which tell some more additional rules and all that. You know, you can play around with what we can write, what we cannot write and all that. But rest is nothing. Okay, I'll write this on neat slate again. And let's continue. Before I go to Jupyter notebook, let's continue. Relearning this. I want to write a square function. Okay, so I'll write def and name of the function square. And then definitely I want to find square of a number. So which number that we are passing and the value that we pass will be received in X. And then indented code that we write is return the square of X. That means whatever value the function received, its square should be returned. Now we know that the function is over. The code of the function is over. So we outdent again. And then we write the main script saying C should be square 2. And then print C. Now let's imagine we write D is equal to square 4. And then print D. How will this main script run? You know, main runs first. So this is called to the function. So 2 goes in X. See what we are passing. So 2 goes in X, function runs. Then function returns 4, 2 into 2. But 4 is returned at the call. Yeah, square 2 is 4. So C becomes 4. then this print will print 4. But now the main script is having one more call. So what? The function will be called all over again. And this 4, the value that we have passed, will be now copied by x. And the function will return 4 into 4, 16. 16 will be returned at the call. So d will become 16 and we are printing d. That's it. So the function can be repeatedly called, isn't it? I hope you got this much. Now, check this statement, okay? This is the function which finds square of a number. Just check this statement. C is equal to square, bracket square, bracket 2, bracket close, and one more bracket open, so bracket close. Just check this line. You know that the name of the function is square. So you know that we are calling function 2 times in the same line. This is called nesting of functions. This is nesting of function calls. One function call can be nested in the other function call. How will this run? Obviously, you know it, I'm sure. I may be wasting your time by telling you this, but you know the rule is always the brackets are solved first. So whatever you have written in the bracket will be solved. What is written in the bracket? Come on, this is the function call. So square is getting called and you are passing 2. So 2 will go in x. Function runs now and function returns 2 into 2, 4. But 4 is returned at the call. Look at this bracket. Inside that bracket, 4 is returned. So this entire line now boils down to square 4. Because this inner square 2 has got evaluated to 4. So this is again a function call. So 4 gets passed in x. And the function returns 4 into 4, which is 16. And now finally c will store 16. Okay. So by nesting square 2 times, we have found 2 raised to 4. Yeah, definitely. We have found 2 raised to 4, isn't it? So nesting is very much possible. Because when the inner function gets called, it returns a value and that value is used by the outer function. And outer function returns a value that is stored in C. Okay. Now have a look at this line. Please become comfortable with very, very fundamentals of functions. See this? Let's say we have again the function square, which returns square of a number. And check this line in the main script. Print square 4. Just check. We are asking print to print the value of square 4. Don't forget this is a function call. So before even print can print something, before print print something, the square 4 is called. So 4 goes in x. The function returns 16. 16 is returned at the call. So this line boils down to print 16. Because the value of square 4 was 16, so 16 will be printed. The same thing could have been done by writing C is equal to square 4. Square 4 and print C. This will also print 16. But instead of wasting a line like this, how about writing square 4 directly within the print? So you will save one variable, you will save this line, and you can directly call square 4 within print. But all this is possible because function returns value at the call. Function returns value at the call. Remember this. That's why print got to know. It understood what to print. Because the 16, value 16 was returned over here. By the way, now let's take a break from this empty slate. And let's go to Jupyter Notebook. Nothing adventurous. I'm going to write the same function, which is define def square, and it has a parameter x. Okay. And then comes the colon character. And then now look, when I hit enter, you know, after this colon character, the cursor is automatically indented. So now whatever you write here, whatever statements you write here are the body of the function, And once you have finished writing it, once you know that the function is over, then you press backspace key, and you outdent, and then you write the main script, whatever is your main script. Okay. I hope you got this. What is this junk I have written? Excuse me. Let's see. But this function has only one line, you know. Return x multiplied by x. And now you see return is such a statement which ends the function. Yeah. Tell me, when return runs, what does it mean? Go back to the caller. So when I am hitting enter here, you know, the cursor will automatically outdent. You just check this. It will directly come out. So I didn't have to press backspace. So return marks the end of the function. Okay, now comes the main script. I will write c is equal to square. This is the name of the function. Oh, sorry. Square. And then 2 maybe. And then I'll say print c. Let's run the code. Obviously, the output will be 4. Isn't it so? Or if I say square 2. So 2 close brackets. Okay, 2 close brackets. So this is going to print 16 due to nesting of functions. One of the biggest problem, you know, when people start thinking about function is that they understand they will give some name. But the big problem is, what is the parameter? When is the parameter needed? When it is not needed? This is the big confusion I have found. Or rather, you know, people get stuck while writing the very first line. They give the name, but then they give open bracket and they keep thinking, shall we give parameter or not? Look, the example which I am going to give you might sound so childish and so funny, but this works. Okay, I'm going to appoint someone here among the participants and I'm going to ask you a question. Okay, and I expect an answer. Saket, are you ready for the question? Tell me the square root of 25.
Obviously 5, sir.
Yes. Super. So when square root is a function, everybody listen carefully. When square root is a function, you just can't shout square root. Are you, who's square root? But when I passed 25 to Saket, square root 25, then Saket received 25 in the parameter in his brain. He received that 25 and then he calculated square root of 25 and returned me the answer. That's the point. When you write a function, you know, function needs some help. I mean, you are going to do some process with some number, but give me that number. So you pass that number. There comes the parameter. Yes, Anmol, do you agree that the parameters are needed most of the times?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now have a look at this. You can design a function which does not have a return statement. It's not compulsion that function must have return. Function may not have return statement. What? You will say, sir, but functions are meant for calculating something and returning that answer. Now, if the functions will not have a return statement, what are they going to do? Here is an example. Now, just imagine I define a function, square again. Again, I define the square function with parameter x, colon. Okay? And what I am doing here is, I am writing print x into x. Just check that. I am not returning x into x. I am printing x into x on the screen. I am not going to give return statement at all in this function. So as return statement is not yet given, you can very well see that the cursor is indented. But your aim is you want to end the function now. So you press backspace and say that is it. That is my function. So tell me in words what this function is going to do. It will take some value, store it in x, and simply print x into x. That's it, an end. But it's not returning a value. Now have a look at this call. C is equal to square 2. This is such a silly statement. Come on. We cannot write such a statement now. Although, you'll say, sir, why? This is called to the function square, and this 2 will go in x, and then function will print 2 into 2, 4 on the screen. But then my point is that the function that we have designed is not returning a value back at the call. See, printing is different and returning is different. Return means it literally returns the value back at the call. But there is no value returned here. If there is no value returned here, what is this poor variable C doing on the left-hand side? Come on. What is the C going to store then? Remember, whenever you as a programmer has designed a function which does not have return statement, then don't make a call by saying somebody equal to square, like C is equal to square. You can't do that because the function call is not going to get back the value. So the function call will be simply square 2. How will this run? You see, this is called to the function. So 2 will go in X and the function is going to print 2 into 2, which is 4 on the screen. And then the function will end because this is the end of the code. That's it. But function is not going to return any value back at the function call. Let's try this. This is going to print 4. But who has printed this 4? The function itself has received the value and printed 4. So you have two options. You can tell Square, calculate the value and return the value. And when you return the value, I will decide what is to be done. In the main script, I may store it in a variable, I may print it, whatever. The another way is, you tell Square that you receive a value, but don't return the answer. You yourself print the answer. In that case, there is no value returned back at the function call. Which method you should use depends. That we have a lot of time in our course to decide, should we write a function which returns a value or should we write a function which does not return a value? What we should do? That we can decide. But I am just telling you that these two types of functions can be designed. Well, both are finding square of a number, but one returns the answer, other just prints the answer. And I also told you then the function call cannot be variable equal to function call. We can't write this. Okay. Secondly, if the function is not returning a value, we can't write square bracket and then square 2. This is rubbish. You note this, that square 2 is a function call, agreed. So 2 will go in X. And function is directly printing 4 on the screen. It is not returning 4 here at the call. Note, if nothing is returned here at the call, then what is this poor square function going to get? Whose square it will find then? So nesting is not possible for this particular type of function, because function doesn't return a value. I hope you got enough of it. I'll just write this square 2 again. This becomes the function call. Okay. So next time, you know, in a large Python code, okay, in very large Python code, if you see some line like this, let's say you see a line transpose A comma B, let's say, and somebody tells you that this is a function, transpose is a function. Okay. Then without even seeing that function, what is written in that function, you can come to one conclusion that the function transpose does not have return statement. Because if there was a return statement, then the call would have been written something like this. But because transpose does not have return statement, the call itself is done in this fashion. Okay. Let's design a very simple function again. Let's say that we have been asked, write a function which returns, clearly it has been said, returns maximum between two numbers. Okay. Use this function to find maximum between four numbers. This is the problem. Okay. Let's first of all figure out the function. Function should find maximum between two numbers. So we will define a function def, and some name you can think of. I have thought of name max because it finds maximum between two numbers. Clearly, it should find maximum between two numbers. So obviously there should be two parameters. That means x will receive some value, y will receive some value, two values will find maximum between these two values, and whatever is maximum, we will return that maximum. Okay, then colon. Now, obviously, we will have if. There is no explanation needed. Come on. We want to know who is larger, x and y, x or y. So we'll ask, is x greater than y? Then colon. Remember the grammar of if. Then we will write return x. If x is greater than y, we will return the value of x. Else, recall the grammar of if again, colon, return y. So this becomes the function. Okay. You simply pass two values to this function. Let's say you have passed 5 and 2, these two values. Then the body of the function will check, is 5 greater than 2, is x greater than y, which is true. So the function will return 5, value of x, back at the calling function. Isn't it? Now, further, the next part of the question is saying, use this function to find maximum between four numbers, it is saying. So what that means is that in the main script, in the just below this def, in the main script, we will do something by which we can find maximum between four numbers. Okay? Just imagine we have defined A as 10, B as 20, C as 30, and D as 15. And we want to know what is the maximum between these four values. And we have to do this by using the function max. And now the problem is, if you say m is maximum, let's say m is equal to max A, B, C, D. Oh, no. This is wrong. This call is wrong, because check, max function has been designed only to receive two values. Check these brackets with max. Max can handle only two values at a time, and you are passing four values. This is too much. So this call is wrong. What you can do is, you can call the max function not to find maximum between four values A, B, C, D, but you call max function like this, m is equal to max A comma B. Oh, this is correct. As you know, A is 10 and B is 20. Max will start with x equal to 10 and y equal to 20. Correct? And then the function will return y. Come on, because y is largest. And you know, 20 will be returned at the call. Hence, m will become 20. Check what is m storing. M is storing largest between A and B. A was 10, B was 20. Function returned largest, that is 20. Now m is storing 20. Okay? But then we had to find largest between A, B, C, D, not A, B. So what? We will call the function again, max. But this time we will call it with m, comma c. What is m already? M is already 20, which is largest between A and B. And C, as you see, is 30. So max function is called again with the values 20, 30. So this time x is 20, as you see, and y is 30. And now the function returns y again, of course, because y is largest, 30. And 30 is returned at the call. And what idea we can apply is, let m itself store this answer. So m becomes maximum between m and c. So now m is 30. Just check, m is now storing largest between A, B, and C. But we had one more number, D. So what we can do is, we can again call the function max with m, which is already 30, comma D. So this call becomes 30, comma 15, because D is 15. And obviously largest, that is 30, will be returned back at the call, and m will become 30. Now you watch, m is 30 finally, and indeed this is the largest between A, B, C, D. So finally, we can print m. M is the largest. You may say, okay, we have found largest between four numbers. that's fine by writing a function, but then there is lot of thinking going behind this. Just check. We could have written this program without function also. I'll write that. I'll just scrap it over here, okay? See, I am not writing any function. In the main script, I am having A is 10, B is 20, C is 30, and D is 15. Four variables. And now I write a if. In main itself, I am not writing a function, remember. And I'll write if A is greater than B, remember, and operator, and A is greater than C, and A is greater than D, colon, then if all of them are true, then A is largest. So I'll print A. A is largest. But what if this is false? This condition is false. So A is not largest. So I'll write else. Remember elif. Elif I will use. Elif. B is greater than A and B is greater than C and B is greater than D. What am I asking now? I am asking, okay, A is not largest, then is B largest? If it is true, then I will print B. But what if this is also false? Oh my God, look at that if. Look at that nested if. It has become so big. So many conditions you have written. Of course, you can write the program without functions. But look at the hard work that you had to do. This continues with elif. Now you will check, is C largest? If C is greater than A and C is greater than B and C is greater than D, if all of them are true, then you will print C. But else, colon, if all of them are false, A is not largest, B is not largest, C is not largest, you will print C. Now look at that, I mean. Just look at this code written on the right-hand side and look at the code written on the left-hand side where we have intelligently written a function which finds largest only between two numbers. And then in main script, we have four numbers. So what? We are calling the function repeatedly every time just to find maximum between only two and only two numbers. Look at the comfort. Now, my question is, what if there was a fifth number also here? And somebody says, no, find maximum between five numbers. Oh my God, you'll say, I will leave it. I'll let it be. Because every time you will have to add one more and condition. And A greater than E. Look at each and every elif. It becomes so big. But what if you are given one more number here and somebody says find maximum between five numbers? You will say nothing to worry. I will add one more line here. M is equal to maximum of M comma E, where M was already 30. I will now take M and the value of E. Find out the maximum. M is still the largest. What an idea. Remember one statement I am making now. Functions are not compulsory. The topic that we are learning is not compulsory. You can write any program without functions. I proved it here. I proved it. This is a program without functions. Functions are not compulsory. You may simply skip. You say, I will never use functions. Because you can write any program without functions. But if you write functions, then you will comfort yourselves. It's not for anybody else. Programmer is helping himself or herself by designing the functions and taking modular approach. Dhanashri, did you like the idea of maximum between four numbers?
Yes, sir. Okay. But when we are using without function, then there is a one step we can add else if D is greater than A and D is greater than B.
Yes, definitely. Okay. Definitely, yes. But then the point is that we can add, but the statements become so big, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, exactly. Very good. Yes.
Sir. What you have written with if else condition, last it should be print D, no, sir? In else.
Yeah, part. Sorry. Print D. I got carried away. Okay. Print D. Dhanashri was also saying the same thing. Okay. So, let's try this. I am trying this, although it has been already solved, but I am trying this so that we can see some more aspects about this max function. So, I am defining max with x, y, two parameters. and then colon indented code, and I will write if x is greater than y colon, then I will say return x, okay, and then else colon I will return y. Okay, this becomes the function. Now in main, as we said, we have a is 10, b is 20, and c is 30, and d is, let's say, 15. And now if I say m is equal to max a comma b, so I am finding maximum only between a and b, storing it in m, then m is equal to max m comma c. So m is already larger between a and b, and I am now comparing it with c and storing the result in m, and finally m is equal to max m comma d. So last thing we will say is print maximum is equal to, and then I will put a comma here and print m. First let's try to run this. Yeah, maximum is 30. Obviously between these four values maximum was 30. Now I'll get back to my empty page here. This page has become too shabby. I'll use a new page. What I want to point out is I'm not writing the entire code again, but you know we have defined one function called max, which has x comma y, okay, and the body which has if else, and then we have a is equal to 10, b is equal to 20, c is equal to 30, I think, and d is equal to 15, and then we said to find maximum we will say max of a comma b, then max of m comma c, correct, and then max of m comma d, and then finally print it. This is what we said. Now my point is, this is a question for all of you. Now what's my point here is that you have written these three lines, you see you have called max three times. Now my point is that these three lines can be written as a single line. I repeat, these three lines can be written as a single line using nesting of functions. You can nest max function one in the other so that you don't have to write three individual lines. You can write m is equal to max, call the function, but inside that you can again call the max function like that. You can use nesting and solve the same problem. So how would you write that nested call? How would you write these three lines in one single line so that we get the same result is my question, and I give you 2 minutes to think over it. Max d comma max c comma max a comma b anmol, perfect answer, absolutely well written. Yeah, so just check this. How would you write this statement, three statements in one line? Nothing extraordinary about it. You see, what you do is you call max function, but you know max can take only two values because that's the way how you have designed max. You can pass only two values to it, but you have four values. So what you do is with max inside, you call max again. You say max bracket. Now you again remember you can pass only two values to max. So how about passing a comma b? Look at this. This becomes a function call max a comma b, and then we will put a comma, and then we will write max c comma d. This is again a function call. Watch this. And then this outer bracket will be closed. How will this run? Now come on, you know that brackets are solved first, but within the bracket we have placed calls two times. The calls are there. So first this max will be called. What are the values? 10 and 20. Note a and b are 10 and 20. So the function receives 10, 20, but the function will return 20 maximum. Na? Maximum is returned here at the call. So do you see outer max is having 20 comma as the value. Now you see max c comma d. This is the second function call, but you know c is 30 and d is 15. So 30 and 15 will be passed to the function, and the function will return 30 at the call maximum. Now this entire thing boils down to max of 20, 30. See how max, outermost max, have got two values which it should compare. And obviously m will become equal to 30 because this function is going to return the value 30. This is it. So you can write this entire three lines in one single line. Okay, let me write it neatly. I mean, there is no preferences that you should nest the function. Anybody writing in this style is always welcome. There is no problem. There is no problem writing right like this. Okay, just I am telling you the possibilities. You can write it as I said, m is equal to max bracket, call max only with two parameters a and b, comma, call max again with two parameters c and d, and then one more close bracket for this. The other way, which Anmol answered, remarkable answer, was m is equal to max a comma. Now watch, max can take only two values. You are passing already one value. Now you can pass only one more value to max. How about calling max again with b comma? And how about calling max again with c comma d? And then this bracket is already closed. Now this outer bracket is now closed and the outermost bracket is again closed. Now you see the innermost call will be done because the innermost bracket is solved first. So max of 30, 15, 30 and 15 will be 30. 30 will be returned here. Now this max will be called with b as 20. You know b is 20 here. So max of 20, 30 will be the call. This will return 30 at the call. And now finally a, 30, this outermost max is going to take a and 30. See, a is 10 and the value of the outer max, this max, which I am underlining, is 30. So the outermost max will evaluate to 30 and m will be 30. This was the answer given by Anmol. Both the methods are correct nesting and all three methods are correct while calling. See, by discussing this all over and over again, you know, what I am trying to remind you is that the basics that we have learned till now about functions, where which method is adaptable. So this is how you can find maximum by saying max of a comma max of b comma max of c comma d, this way or this way. Coming back to Jupyter notebook, these three lines, as I was saying, can be replaced very well with nested calls. Like m is equal to find maximum of a comma maximum of b comma maximum of c comma d, and then print m, which will definitely print 30. Okay, now what? Now you see, have you observed that two examples we saw, square and max, two functions, in both these examples we are defining the function first and then we are writing main script. You know, main script will run first, isn't it? And then it will call the function, which is written on top. A question comes in our mind that can we do something like this? What we can do is we can remove the function from top. Okay. And how about writing this function below the main script? Here. I mean, what do you say about this? Now, in both these examples, we first defined the function and then we wrote main script. But now the function itself has been defined below and main has been written above. And look, main is going to make use of this max function, which is defined below. Okay. Now, if you try to run this, just check. Okay. For some reason, you know, I'll just change the name of this function. I'll tell you the reason later. I'll just change the name. I will name this function as maximum. Just for explanation's sake, I'm changing the name. Maximum. Here it goes. Maximum. Okay. Okay. This is the function that we have defined. Fine. Now, but the function has been defined below. Let's try to run this and it will give error. You see, I have not defined the function above main script. I have defined it below main script. And the function gave an, there was an error. And the error, you can see, was exactly at the line where we are calling the function. This was the function call. And it says, maximum is not defined. Come on, we have defined maximum. Good Lord. We have defined maximum, but it gives error. Maximum is not defined. Strange. Rule in Python is that functions must be defined above the call. Just check my words. Where is the call? Call is over here. From here, you are calling the function. So this function must be defined above the call. Remember this. Okay. So I'll just cut this and I'll paste it. But the function must be defined above, not below. So the function was if x greater than y colon return x. What I was saying is the function must be defined above, always above the call. So this time when I define this function above the call, you know, the function is going to work. Just check this. Return y. Okay. And now when I run this, this function is going to print 30. But the same function, when I defined it below the call, it gave error, function not found. So remember, functions must be defined above the function call. Okay. Now your obvious question would be, when this function was named as max, and when I wrote it below the call, it worked. Hana? That's because there was a function max defined by me above the function call in the previous code. You just check, I had defined a function max just few minutes back above the call, and that max function was registered and it still is alive. That max function was still alive and that max function was properly interpreted. So that's why I purposely changed the name of the function as if it is a new function, which was unknown by Python. And that gave error when this was defined below the call. So one more fundamental we saw. Now, can we define a function without a parameter? Check my question. Here is the question. Question is, function without parameter. Without parameter. That means, can you imagine a function something like this, def, f1, some function, and bracket. Brackets are compulsory. Whether parameter is present or not, bracket must be given. So there is no parameter to this function. But still brackets are written, and then some statements inside the function. So I said very early, function may or may not have parameter, isn't it? Some functions do not have parameter. Like, as an example, that develop a function which prints welcome to Python. That's it. So we have to define a function, let's say f1, and whenever this f1 function runs, it should print welcome to Python. Okay, now you only tell me, what is the need of the parameter here? Are we going to pass any value? No. Just check, the function will not have any parameter because the function does very simplistic job to print welcome to Python. That's it. And now in the main script, I will just place the call f1. Look, even when I call the function, I have to write the bracket, although I am not passing any value. So this f1 starts and it simply prints welcome to Python. I can call this function any number of times. Any number of times I call it, it will still print the same output. So when you know that the function is going to do monotonous job, it's not going to require some input. Like, as I was asking Saket, what is square root? And he was unable to answer. But when I asked him, what is square root of 25? He immediately said 5. Obviously, 5 was his answer. But there are many examples where we monotonous job. In that case, the function doesn't require any parameter. Just check that when such a function is written, I'll define some function called f1 without any parameter, and this is simply printing, print, let's say, welcome to Python. That's it. This is what the function is doing. And now I want that the function should end, so I'll press backspace, and then I'm calling the function. Let's call the function again. Let's call it again. But each time I call, I will not pass any parameter because that was not needed. The function is going to do simplistic, monotonous job every time. So when I run this, it is going to print welcome to Python 3 times because the function was called 3 times. Most of the times, you know, such functions which do not have parameters are normally used for some monotonous job, like at the beginning of your software, you might need to show a welcome screen, maybe. And then while ending, if the user presses exit your application, if exiting the application, you may have to say a goodbye message. You can develop such functions where you can obviously welcome, or you can say goodbye to your user. Okay. So functions may not have parameters in such simplistic case. Okay. Now, what do you do after this? Where do you go after this in the functions chapter? Is there are many hidden concepts about functions. Like, you know, this parameter which I said itself is a very interesting topic. Okay. So I'm going to tell you something about that parameter now, and how that parameter, you know, behaves is very interesting to see here. Look, for seeing how the parameter behaves, I'm going to write one arbitrary function. This function is just written for fun to tell you how the parameter behaves. So suppose I have parameter x. See, f2 is the name of the function, x is the parameter. And in this function, I am writing x is x plus 1. Okay. So whatever I receive in the function, I will increase that by 1. Okay. And then I am printing the value over here, print x. Just check the code. Suppose x received by the function is 5. Then x will become 6. And 6 is printed. Fine. And then I will end the function. I am not returning a value from this function. I repeat, don't think why the function is written like this. It is just written like that. Some statements I have written, okay? And you know, whatever statements have been written in the function will execute. Now here is the main. In main, I am having a equal to 1. And then I call the function f1a, okay? And then I print a. Now have a look at this. How will this run? What will be the output? Now, first thinking that the beginner may have is a is 1 in the main script, then f1 is called. And look, what is the value of a that we are passing? 1. That 1 will go in x. Agreed, everyone? So what is the value of x? X is 1. Then the function starts and makes x as 2. Because x was 1, so x will become 2. And this line is going to print 2. Okay, so 2 has got printed, and now the function ends and we get back to main, and look, the function is over now. So the next line will run. We are printing a. Now here starts the confusion. What confusion? We passed a to x. X was 1, then x became 2. 2 was printed. Now when we come back over here and when we are trying to print a, will a be 1 or will it be 2? Come on, because we have passed a to the function, it was received by x, x increased, x became 2, 2 was printed, and now we came back. So will a be a changed value? Will a also become 2 or will a remain 1? The answer is a will remain 1. A will remain 1. When you pass something to a function in a parameter, and if you change the value of that parameter, that parameter is increased here. Although you change the value of the parameter, the original value that you have passed does not change. It remains safe as it was earlier. So when you come back from the function, a is not 2, a is still 1. Let me prove it. Oh, there is some error over here. Let me check what error we have got. the name of the function is wrong. I should call F2A. Okay. Because the function is F2. Okay. Let me run it again. See, this 2 has been printed by the function because x received by 1, x received was 1, then x increased to 2, then 2 was printed. Correct? But then when we come back and when we want to print A is still 1. You note this last print has printed 1. That proves that although you are passing A in X and although you are increasing X, that changes made to X are local to the function. Any changes made in the parameter will not affect the original value passed. I hope you are understanding that, you know, it's like, you know, making a photocopy or a Xerox copy and sending that. So X is a Xerox copy of A. Whatever happens to your Xerox copy doesn't change your original document. Original document was A and it remains safe. This type of calling is called call by value. Yes, you might have learned this in your semester somewhere in programming. If you have, call by value this is. Because when you call the function, value is passed. Value of A is 1. So 1 is passed to X. And then whatever changes made to X does not affect A. There is another type of calling called call by reference. Okay? Call by reference. But is this clear, first of all? Any changes? Suppose A is 1 and I call F1A and I subtract. If I say X is X minus 1, in that case, X will become 0. Only X will become 0, A won't become 0. So the output will be 0, 1. See, the last print is still printing 1. This proves that this is called by value. Okay, I'm writing one more function now. Define F3 and let's pass a parameter X. Okay, so X is the parameter and I say X of 0 should become 100. You will know what I'm writing, okay? Here is the main script. I will say A is equal to 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Don't tell me you don't know this. This is list. A is a list of numbers containing 5 numbers. And you know 10 has index 0, 20 has index 1, and so on. Okay. Now, I call the function F1 pass A. What am I passing? Come on. What am I passing? I am passing a list. A is a list. Observe. I am passing the list. And that list goes in X. Agreed? So what is X? X is a list. Why? Because A is a list. A is a list. I am passing a list. So X is a list. And then I am saying X0 should become 100. What that means is 0th element of the list should become 100. But does that mean that 0th element of A will become 100? Does it mean that any changes made to the parameter do not affect the original value passed? We said that. But will, in this case, will it affect this 10? X0, will it become 100? Yes, it will become 100. In this case, A is affected. Why? Because lists are always passed by reference. List, tuple, set, dictionary, all these data structures are always passed by reference. So when you pass a list, you receive a list. Then you can peep in the 0th position, first position, second position, play with that, change the values. Whatever changes you do in the function will affect the original variable. Let us prove that by printing A. You know, just to print the list, if you want to print the list, you simply print A. That's it. So what should be the output? Check that. Oh, there is again some typo error. This should be F3. I'm so sorry. The function call should be F3. Okay. So if I run this now, let's look at A0. A0 is 100. You are eligible to shout here. You would say, sir, we did not make A0 as 100. We made X0 as 100. Where did we make A0 as 100? But the point is, A was passed by reference. So X refers A. X is now same as A. So whatever changes you do in X will affect A. This is true with list, sets, tuples, dictionaries. All of them are passed by reference. But simple integer variable, integer value, this is not a list, come on, A is not a list. This is not passed by reference, this is always passed by value. Just check, if I had A as 1.5, you know A is a float now. Correct? A is a float, but still it is a very primitive variable. It's not a data structure like list or tuple. And then we are calling the function by passing 1.5 value of A. 1.5 goes in X, then X decreases, so it becomes 0.5. So 0.5 is printed, and when we come back, don't expect A to be 0.5. Correct? Don't expect it. It remains 1.5. Any changes made to the primitive value, primitive variable, won't affect the original variable. Okay? So, after learning what these parameters can be, is it call by value or call by reference? If somebody maybe is playing a quiz with you and tells you that there is a function call like this, F4A, okay? F4A. This is a function call, somebody tells. And then asks, is this call by value or call by reference? The answer you give is, I don't know. I can't tell. Because it depends on who is this A. If A was a simple integer, then this is call by value. If A was a list, then it is call by reference. So you tell me what is A, only then I will be able to tell whether it is call by value or call by reference. So there is more to this parameter, but you know how much in Python, at least, is, just check this. How much Python functions help us is Python offers something called unnamed function, also called as anonymous functions, which does not have name. So one way we saw is you write define and then you write name of the function, isn't it? And then the parameter and then the body. So this function is having name. It is a named function. But in Python, you can define a function which does not have a name. Now the big question is, which comes to your mind is, if the function does not have a name, how are you going to call that function? Come on, if I say there is a person who does not have a name, but then how will you call that person? So I am saying that the function will not have a name. Big question is, while calling from the main script, how are you going to call? Okay, this is what we are going to discover tomorrow when we learn lambda functions. Very interesting topic, very, very interesting. At 11 o'clock, tomorrow we have a class, lambda functions will tell us how to design anonymous functions. Now the other thing very interesting in Python functions is you can design nested functions. No, I am not talking about nested calls, which we were saying call max, again inside that call max, again inside that call max. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about nested function. That means you can define a function, let's say f1, okay, and you can start writing the function. Now within this function, you can define another function. And you can write body of this function. Okay? This is called nested function. You see, how is F2 function defined? F2 function is defined in the body of F1. And there is no limit. You can nest the functions till any level. You can again define one more function inside F2. This is nested function. So this we will see tomorrow, okay? But now, before we leave today, something more about parameters I want to talk about. We will talk about parameter. We saw what is call by value and call by reference. Now just imagine we have a function like this, define f1 x, okay? And I have said return x into x, simple. Now, somebody calls this function like this, c is equal to f1, 2, 3. You straight away say that this is wrong, because you cannot call the function by passing two values, because function has been designed to receive only one value. isn't it so? So while calling a function, programmer must know how many parameters exactly are to be passed. Just as another example, suppose we have defined a function f1 with two parameters x and y, and the function is doing something immaterial. Just think that function as somebody, and somebody calls this function as f12. Now this is also wrong, because the function is designed to have two parameters. So while calling the function, you must pass two parameters compulsorily. So 2, 3 is okay, because the two parameters have been defined here. So please try to understand these parameters, you know, are also called as required parameters. Whatever you like, you can say compulsory also, because you have to pass them, pass their values. They are called required parameters, or they are also called as positional parameters. Positional, why? Because you said 2, 3, look at the call, 2, 3. Did you tell that 2 should be copied in x? Did you tell that 3 should be copied in y? But Python understands that the first value should be copied in first parameter and second value should be copied in second parameter. So position decides, isn't it? Which value you are passing first, which value you are passing second. So according to their positions, the values will go in the parameters neck to neck, correct or not. So the parameters, don't get surprised in some quiz if they ask what are positional parameters or required parameters. You simply say the parameters which we write are positional parameters with the function. But there are four types of parameters that you can define in the function. First one is called required parameter, as we saw. Required parameter. The second is called variable number of parameters. Third one is called keyword parameter. Keyword parameter. And fourth one is known as variable number of keyword parameters. All this, you know, has been designed so thoughtfully by Python that I promise, trust me, when we will learn machine learning models and how to design those in Python, all these basics that we are learning will come into picture. And you will suddenly see that Python has some ready-made function, but there is a keyword parameter in that function. So we will remind all over again about these things when we use those functions which are given by Python. But then the first one you already know, required parameter. Now what is the second one? Variable number of parameters. Very simple. It is going to hardly take not more than say 5 minutes. I'll directly take you to an example. Okay. That's always better. I'll take you to an example. See, I am defining a function f4. Okay. And look at the parameter I am writing. Asterisk, that star symbol, args. Okay. Nothing special about this name args. If you don't like it, you can write asterisk x also. Okay. But most of the authors write it as args. Now watch. After this, I have given colon, and I will simply say print args. Now this asterisk args, you know, this is a tuple. It's a tuple. And this tuple is going to store whatever parameters you pass. And then we are printing this tuple. You will know what I am talking about. Let's go to main script. The function is over. Now I am calling the function f4 with parameters 10, 20, 30. Now at this point, you know, you should shout, sir, you are passing three values, 10, 20, 30. In that case, the f4 function should have been written as x, y, z. Come on, we have spoken about it. You are passing 10, 20, 30. So there should be three placeholders. X will receive 10, Y will receive 20, Z will receive 30. You should have three function parameter. But note, what we have written is, we have not written any parameter. We have written asterisk args. Now what happens is, This is called as variable number of parameters. And these values, 10, 20, and 30, will literally get copied in a tuple called ARGS. And this tuple will receive all the values. Okay? Let's try to run this. Just check. After printing ARGS, we are getting a tuple. ARGS is a tuple which has received all three values. What if I call the function like this? Watch. 10, 20, let's say. Only two arguments I have passed. So what? Now this ARGS will be a tuple which stores only 10, 20. Okay? And what if I pass 10, 20, 30, 40, 50? No problem. You can pass any number of parameters to this function. And what if I pass nothing? Oh, good Lord. If I pass nothing, no problem. ARGS will be empty. So if you are shown this function, somebody shows this function to you and asks you, how many parameters can you pass to this function? Answer is, you will say any number of parameters. When I say any, even zero parameters are possible. But if somebody shows you this function, just check, x, y, and asks you how many parameters you can pass to this function, you should say two and only two, not even one, not even three. This is fixed number of parameters, but we can design a function which says that, okay, pass me anything, I will copy it in the tuple, and then you can enjoy that tuple. What that enjoy is, I will tell you. But then you see, you are free to call the function with any number of parameters now. This is that what I was talking about, variable number of parameters. And the first one was required. I'll tell you the application of this, where variable number of parameters are used. Not now, at least you get used to the syntax first. Okay. What I was telling is, there's no rule that you should write ARGS. It's just used by authors because ARGS means arguments. So it looks nice, but you can name this as X, no problem. But then make sure you use the same name everywhere in the rest of the function. This asterisk is not the pointer, like in C, C++. It's just a convention that when you write asterisk x, it means tuple, variable number of parameters. So if I call the function as 10, 20, 30, now we will get a tuple. The tuple is x, and x is storing 10, 20, 30. Okay? So here is the last question for the day. And then we will stop for tomorrow. The question is, write a function which will add any amount of numbers. Any amount of numbers. Now just check, if the question was, write a function to add two numbers, check my words, then it was so easy for you. You will say define sum x, y, because you want to add only two numbers, and you will say return x plus y, addition of the two numbers, and from main script you will say c is equal to sum 10, 20. So obviously the value returned will be 30 and you will print C. But the point is that this sum may not always take two parameters, is the question. Sum should be able to add any amount of numbers. So maybe you will first call sum like this. Next time you will call sum as sum. I want to add 100, 200, 200, 300, three values. So the same sum function should be able to run with two parameters or three parameters or n parameters. Okay. So how do you write such a function? You straight away say that sum is a function which will take any number of parameters, variable number of parameters. Sometimes we may pass two parameters, sometimes three, sometimes n parameters. So in your English statement itself, you know that sum is not going to have a fixed number of parameters because we want to add any amount of numbers. So it will have variable number of parameters. And how do you write variable number of parameters? You will define a function sum by writing asterisk args, isn't it so? And then you will write colon, and then you will write the function body. I am not discussing the function body. Hello. I'm not telling you how to add them, but are you understanding the need for the variable number of parameters? If it was only two numbers, you can write this function and forget. But note, this function will not work for this call because now you want to add three numbers. And sometime later, you may have to add four numbers. Then the same function should work with variable number of parameters. Okay, but then I am not telling you the code right now. How do you add them? Just have patience. Okay, we will learn how to add those numbers. But then that's what is the variable number of parameters. Bye. See you. Good night.